Virtual Home Visit for a Child with Medical Complexity, Feeding Tube Care, by Dr. Kathleen Huth in the Virtual Home Visit Working Group.
So the G-tube was a new environment for us when we decided that transitioning from oral feeding to G-tube feeding was really a necessity. Even though Jack enjoyed the flavors of the food, it was more of a risk for Jack because of the thin liquid in his mouth and the opportunity for aspiration. And so as tough as it was to make that decision to take away that one area of stimuli, the sense of taste, moving to a G-tube was essential for his ability to continue to thrive. And so we made the decision and we came in here to Children's and we had the procedure performed. And you get a lot of information. It's kind of scary. You know, there's a tube going into the belly from the outside, and it's like, oh, that got to be really super careful and whatnot. And so you go home with a set of instructions. If it comes out, you have X amount of minutes to get it back in, and otherwise it starts to, you know, to seal back up and this and that. And so all sorts of things to think about. And sure enough, you know, we weren't home but probably 20 minutes, and you know, with the new tube, it's a long one and whatnot, and it got caught on I think a coat when we were taking it off, and it popped right out. And you know, we called the number, and you know, we need help, you know, what are we supposed to do and whatnot. And so Irene, you know, is tracking that down, and I'm trying to read through all the material, and I'm like, well, we're time's ticking. All right, look, it's a hole. Tube, get it in. We learned later that there was water in a balloon and there's things that you could have done to maybe lubricate. None of that was in the material, actually. And so I got a fully inflated balloon back into the hole. You do what you have to do. But now we know, and changing the tube is second nature. It's nothing to be scared of. And I, you know, I've walk through it with our nurses on multiple, you know, every nurse is, you know, well, we haven't encountered that. And so, okay, that's fine. You know, nobody does everything. And so this is something that, having done it over years now, it's comfortable. As a parent, you kind of become a nurse, right? You know, in a certain circle, I don't want to, you know, I'm not putting a doctorate on the wall, but there are things that you do that are more advanced than some medical professionals deal with on a regular basis. So you kind of have to help them through. But it was a new world. And I think that our experiences actually were very helpful to at least one other family when Jack was in the hospital, and they were, you know, paired up in Jack's room and having, you know, concerns about a tube. And I'm like, you know, come on over, take a look. This is what Jack has. And, you know, these were the questions that we had, and sure enough, you know, when the doctors came in, you know, I could hear the parents over there asking those same questions and getting the answers that, you know, they were concerned about. And it was kind of nice to know that, you know, our experiences were able to help somebody else. But it's one of those things that freaks you out in the beginning, but over time you get used to it. Yeah, I think, you know, everybody's concerned about what happens if it pops out and what do you do. And with Jack's medication, he's on a myriad of medications. We have encountered a situation where still some uncertainty as to whether or not there were some issues with the batches or whatnot. But we were going through balloons at a rapid pace. The balloons themselves were degrading. They were popping. And his tube was coming out. You know, we were concerned because these are devices that are supposed to, you know, last, you know, they're supposed to be changed like every 3 months or you know, at a less frequent interval. And so, you know, there was a long period of time where we were trying to troubleshoot what's going on. You know, is it that the balloon was inflated too much and the compressions from the chest PT vest might be wearing it down, or all of the combinations of medicines that go in all at once, are they just sitting in the belly and you know, eating away at the balloon and what can we do and whatnot? And I you know, we spend a significant amount of time focusing on how we ensure that his G-tube stayed intact. And we've been much more fortunate with the, you know, the later additions of the tubes that we've received that I think we've been able to go for 2 to 3 months now without having those concerns. And but it, you know, it's that challenge. And what do you do if you're traveling? Yeah, we keep a backup in the car. We have backups at school, but you have to have a backup. And you know, it's the size of a book, right? So not something you just stick in your back pocket. It's something you have to prepare for and anticipate that if the tube comes out, if the balloon pops, what do you do?
Jack has a balloon-based gastrostomy tube for nutritional support due to a history of dysphagia and risk of aspiration. It is important to know what type of G-tube your patient has, when it was inserted, and with what indication, so that you can help provide guidance on its routine care and troubleshooting. Here are some tips on routine care of balloon-based gastrostomy tubes. Though your patient should be advised not to take a bath for 1 week after placement, after this time, there are no restrictions on activity, including bathing, going to the pool, or the beach. The tube should be stabilized with tic-tac-toe taping for a minimum of 6 weeks after placement. Once the tube is in place for 12 weeks, the tract is considered stable. You should be able to rotate the tube with a dime's width underneath. Children may need their tube to be upsized over time, increasing the size of the tube as the child grows. Caregivers should check the volume of water in the balloon weekly. The G-tube is typically changed every 3 to 4 months, or sooner, if fluid is leaking from the middle of the G-tube, which may mean that the G-tube's one-way valve is worn down. Or, if water is missing from the balloon after 2 weekly balloon checks, this may also be an indication to replace the tube earlier. Caregivers should be advised to flush the tube before and after feeds and medications to prevent clogging. And the tube should be cleaned daily with warm and soapy water. You can advise families that they can remove the G-tube extension tubing when possible so it doesn't get caught on clothing or other objects. What should you advise families if the G-tube comes out? It is really important to ask when the tube was inserted. If it has been less than 12 weeks since insertion, there is a risk of tract disruption, so a trained person will have to replace it. Caregivers should be advised to not panic. Nothing should be inserted into the site, and the stoma should be covered with gauze to soak up drainage. It is important that they present to hospital within 1 to 2 hours, otherwise the site may start to close up. Placement should be confirmed after reinsertion based on the guidelines at your institution, which may include aspiration of gastric secretions and confirmatory G-tube study, which is a contrast-enhanced X-ray. Caregivers should keep a replacement G-tube, spare syringe, roll of tape, and lubricant with the child. What should you advise if the tube is clogged? Families should slowly flush with 5 to 10 milliliters of warm water. For long G-tubes, families can try to milk the tubing to remove any kinks. For low-profile or skin-level balloon G-tubes, the extension tubing set can be changed if it is visibly clogged. Do not try to push an object into the G-tube to unclog it. Families should not use any sticky products like carbonated beverages or cranberry juice to try to unclog the G-tube. If unable to clear the tube, the family should call the clinic or provider responsible for the child's G-tube care. The tube may need to be replaced. Clogging of the tube can be prevented with routine flushing of the tube before and after medications and feedings. It is important to know that there is a higher risk of clogging with crushed medications versus liquid formulations. And certain medications should not be administered via G-tube, including clarithromycin and K-exalate, due to high risk of clogging. Medications that are sustained-released or enteric-coated should not be crushed. What should be done if the G-tube is leaking? A tube may be leaking due to ineffective gastric seal, inadequate balloon volume, or ineffective stabilization. You should assess the tube fit, check the balloon volume, and stabilize the tube with tic-tac-toe taping. Families can use an absorbent foam dressing instead of gauze, as the gauze can stay wet on the skin. There are a number of different issues that can occur with the skin around the G-tube. You may note local skin irritation from leakage of gastric contents. Families can use absorbent topical powder, a foam dressing, and consider the use of a barrier cream, a stringent solution, or a topical steroid for contact dermatitis. Granulation tissue is the growth of excess pink or red tissue protruding from the stomacyte, representing overgrowth of new capillaries, which may bleed easily when touched. It can be caused by excessive movement of the tube in the tract due to improper fit or improper stabilization. Management may include stabilizing the tube, using steroid cream, or silver nitrate application by a trained personnel. Local infection is a common post-insertion complication. Antibiotics such as cefalexin may be used, and the child should be monitored for any signs of systemic infection. Consider a skin or wound culture if the infection is recalcitrant, as it may be growing methicillin-resistant Staph aureus. Candida is another potential issue, in which case an antifungal agent should be prescribed.